All right, I'm going to get started. I think most people have arrived. Hello, everyone. Welcome to MCC Art Department's Visiting Artist Program. I'm the art gallery curator here at McHenry County College. This is the second artist talk we've done with an exhibiting artist, which I know I'm biased, but I think it's pretty exciting to have the artists here and have their artwork up on the walls for everybody to see. You know, it's a fantastic opportunity for MCC students and the community to have a chance to hear directly from the artist, hear about their artwork and their process directly from their own lips. I wanted to take a moment to thank a few people before we get started. First of all, I want to thank Paul Bear and the IT department for helping set this all up for us. I'd also like to thank our photography instructor, Justin Schmitz. He's my co-conspirator in today, getting everything arranged. And finally, I'd like to thank Daniela Broderick, the Dean of Arts and Humanities, for her continued support of the arts program here at MCC. Now I'm going to read a quick little intro of Daniel before I introduce him to you all. Our artist again is Daniel Ramos. Daniel is a current NYSCA, NYFA Artist Fellow for Photography and was awarded the 2022 Sprouting Spaces Residency by Clementina Arts Foundation in Connecticut. He was the 2021-2022 Fellow of Next Haven in New Haven, Connecticut, the 2021 Artist in Residence at Lightwork in Syracuse, New York, and held the 2020-21 Pollock Krasner Residency at ISCP in Brooklyn. In March 2020, Daniel completed the Spring International Artist in Residence Program at ArtSpace in San Antonio, Texas. He taught photography at Texas State University, where in the fall of 2022 semester, he was awarded the Dorothea Lange Paul Taylor Prize in 2018. He received his Bachelor of Arts in Photography from Columbia College, Chicago. Daniel and his wife, Christina, and their son, Max, all live in New York City. So please join me in welcoming Daniel Ramos.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for a lovely introduction, Trevor. I am really happy in being here today. It's actually, how do I explain it? It's kind of surreal to me. You know, Trevor and Justin, we met at Columbia College 20 plus years ago. And a lot of the work that you see here today and that's on the walls and what I will be showing here in this presentation, some of it was made while we were students, a lot of this work. And I want to start speaking about the title, 8 hours don't make a day. I decided to title this project or this exhibition thinking about this series, which is Sloan Valve. Sloan was a company that my father worked for 40 plus years, and he retired recently. And I decided to title this series thinking about how much of your day belongs to you. You know, the man could own you for 8 hours, but he doesn't own the whole day. So I really took that into heart, because what you see on those walls is basically my choice of being an artist. I was working in this factory, and this picture that you see up now is me. And I decide to make a portrait of myself in every series that I'm working in. And I do that because in some way I'm directly related to the subject matter that I choose to photograph. It's also a reflection of who I am. And the Sloan series I made those photographs when I was 18, 20 years old. And it was a time where I was actually learning how to use the camera that I was interested in learning how to master, which was a 4x5 camera. And here's an image where I am photographing myself and my father, which I've never shown this picture before. I didn't know that I had a picture of my father in this series. But at the same time, as I was trying to learn how to use this camera, I also had to learn how to speak to people in having their portrait made. And as students, you know, I remember when other lectures were happening at Columbia and artists will come by and I will see their work. My question was always, or this enigma that I had was, how did he convince those people to have their portrait made? And as I was doing this work, I went through massive rejection. And being an insider didn't help the situation. You know, I thought that by me being an employee there and trying to photograph my friends will really make it easy for me. On the contrary, it was actually harder. They were very susceptible. You know, they were suspicious of my act. I don't know why. So for me to make a portrait, it took about 6 months of asking. And in the meantime, this image, I'm like, my father can't say no to me for a picture. But he actually did. And it was like, if you're in it, then I'll have the picture. You know, you could take my photograph. So I said, okay, fine. And I did this. But it really, you know, when you're out there and you're interested in photographing a certain community or a place, it's important for you to remember that you need to show your presence there, you know, be there. And I didn't know that at the time, but me coming in with my camera day to day, and then, you know, my employees, you know, my friends seeing me like, this guy is like really, really interested in making pictures here, that they took it into account later. But what I wanted to show about them at the time, I didn't know exactly what that was. You know, I just knew that I could make beautiful pictures in this space. Now, reflecting back at it, right? I look and I say, wow, how was I able to really show a side of a working class, you know, socially, and show these pictures of dignity. But I didn't know that, you know, when I was out making these images. And then I also was photographing the spaces, but all of this, these images were made because of the rejection. So I said, I'm gonna go scout inside this factory for spaces that I could then put my subjects in. So I didn't snooze with time. I thought that in the meantime, I could go out and make sketches. But at the same time, I'm looking at these spaces, and even though there's no people in them, it feels like there's people. And here's a picture again of me. And now it's if you see the shape of it, it's actually the film. It's a contact sheet. It's actually not a photograph made out of a negative. This is a print made out of a print. And I decided to do this because I wanted to show how I was photographing in a with a large format camera. But this image that you're looking at is actually the first picture that I made of people with. This is really triggered for other people to be photographed. And this man, Eugene, was the first person to agree to have his picture made. But again, he had to make a picture of me first, exactly what I want him to do, and then I photographed him. So right now, Justin was joking, but I will go back. It's the same thing. So what you're seeing here in this series, and in most of my work, none of these things actually ever happened. You know, these moments. I recreated this. but through the idea of being rejected, that's what allowed me to start using my imagination with how can I use textures, walls, be it as something that will also inform something about the character of that person. Again, like these are all inside a machine. And I was thinking of how can I express more of about the person using the environment. But at the same time, how do I focus? How do I set everything up? So imagine you're in a factory and you're carrying one strobe and your view camera, and you only have 15 minutes. I was only allowed to photograph, which is an important detail, only during our mutual breaks. This was not something that could happen during their work time. So again, I had to deal with convincing people to sacrifice their smoke break or their chill time to actually have a picture made of themselves with a very cumbersome camera. So again, I mean, I'm like sweating and nervous, but all that rejection and being able to find the locations allowed me to be prepared for something like this. So the thing now to remember from the rejection is that you could look at that as something negative, but at the same time, it could be something positive because it will allow you to seek some other things out. So next time you ask yourself and you want to make a picture of someone, do ask that person. And if you get rejected, just figure out other ways to make a picture of that environment. This work is something that I did such a long time ago, you know, and putting it together for this exhibition, I had no clue that I was going to be able to one day to resign from this factory and do what I'm doing now. So this 8 hours don't make a day. I was actually really in awe that what you're looking at is a whole body of work that I've done year, per, like, you know, with time. And the, you know, there's another series in the hall, which is the most recent work, and it's Eres Muy Hermosa. And those pictures were made in 2018, 2019. And right now, as I was speaking to Trevor, this idea about the gaze and me being a man and then photographing women. And in this factory that I worked at, there was a lot of women working there. But at the time, you know, again, I'm 18 or 19, I was very shy in approaching a woman to have their picture made. I was very conscious of that. And I actually never share that with anyone but just myself. I mean, it's something that one thing, getting rejected by a man to make their picture is one thing, but then being rejected by a woman is a whole different thing, being a man. And the context and how I approached to be, you know, to make these pictures was very difficult for me. And if you see the night series in this bar and you see the photographs of women compared to the photographs I made of women in this factory, they're very different. Like, I was more clear with the idea of what I wanted to make, why I wanted to make their picture. And, you know, I think it's something that I will continue to explore and to learn about. And I photographed here for a year, about 2 years. And another question that arose was, when do you know the series was done? You know, when is it that you know that you finished with a project? And I started noticing that I was making the same picture, but with different people. And this photograph, for example, this man retired. That was his last day, and that was the machine that he worked at for X amount of years. And it was really something for me, because as I made this picture, I remember that I said to myself, this is it. I can't be making more photographs here. And yet I didn't want to stop, but the labor of it, of making, it really just was going nowhere. And here is the image of the actual parts that we polished. This is what I will actually polish with the machine. And when my father retired, this is the token that he received. It's a lamp. And I thought that this piece itself was also an art object to me. And I thought it was funny that after working for so long, you get this lamp, right? And I told my father that if he leaves me anything, to please leave me this lamp. Which reminds me that when I decided to pursue my career as a student full time, I actually was granted a trip to Russia back in 1999, 2000. And I got permission. It was a leave of absence from the factory to go out there and I was out there for like 4 months. And I kid you not that when I was in Moscow, I went to the restroom, I go urinate, and I look at this valve that I'm about to flush. And something hit me in the head. I said, how can it be that I'm on the other side of the world doing this, and I have to go back and polish this all over again? It didn't work. It didn't register that when I came back, I actually resigned. And that was a big, big, big blow to my father, because he wanted me to continue working here. The series, The Land of Illustrious Men, is really about you making those choices about, you know, am I going to go deep into this? You know, that this lamp represents that to me. I still remember that day, that bathroom. Kid you not. I flushed it and I came out like I was enlightened. I didn't know the path, you know, what an artist is. And it took me a long, long time to actually describe myself to other people as an artist. Because you don't do that. You know, in my environment, the people that are around me, they have no clue how I make a living. They can't understand the concept of how do you make money, you know, selling pictures. It's like, who buys that? Or how does this work? You know? And here is the beginning. If I don't know how many have you had the chance to look at the book, The Land of Illustrious Men started as a book. I did not think of it as an exhibition. I did not think of it as, I wanted to make a really beautiful object. And at the time that I came to this idea, I was living in Mexico with my wife. We decided to move to Mexico in 2014, and she was pregnant at the time. It was a really one of those choices, again, where I needed to leave the United States for some time. And being out in Mexico, I said, what can I do out here for work creatively? And Monterrey, where I'm currently, that's where I'm from, my family's from, is about an hour and a half to 2 hours to the border, to the Texan border. And I said, I would like to make pictures about people that are trying to migrate into this country illegally. And in the process of doing that, I started reflecting upon my life about how did my parents come to the United States, I'm first generation. And I said, why am I trying to photograph other people that are trying to cross when my own family, my father, did that himself? He came into this country illegally. So I started to reflect and going through my negatives and going through personal items or like letters, the photographs that my parents made. And that's why the logic of the book, I started to put these things together. And in doing so, I came to a lot of ideas. And one of them, when people ask me, like, you know, is this a project about identity? I don't think so. I've never had a doubt about who I am. You know, I am from the city. I'm originally from the city of Chicago. I was born and raised in Chicago. I grew up with house music, jazz, and all of that. So I've never identified as a Mexican. And I speak Spanish fluently. And most Mexicans don't know that I'm from the United States until I tell them. But ironically, once I let them know that I am from the United States, they don't consider me Mexican, you know. But then in the United States, it's funny that people tell me that my English is really good. And I'm like, well, yours is too, and so. I think that the identity thing was really not an issue. It was more me making a stance of where I belong, or like how I am a part of this, you know. And that really made me, as I was making the book, these ideas were cooking in my head. And I said, what images show that? And I don't know, maybe in the future, you might be interested in making a narrative about a story you want to tell. I encourage that, I tell everyone that the things that are more interesting in the world are actually right in front of your face. They're there. And the Sloan series, these photographs, these images were all made, so a lot of them were made for exercises in how to use a camera or how to work with color. I made this photograph in Photo 2, how to make color images. At the time, I wanted to make an image that I could immortalize my mother. Every time I would come back from school, that's how she looked at me when I was going into my room. And I wanted to keep that forever. So I told her, like, really simple, I want to make this picture. You know, I'm like coming back from school, pretend I'm coming back, and, you know, do what you do. Until she finally put her hands there, and my father, that's how he eats. And that's another example. But to me, that's a great example of what I'm trying to explain, that you might think that you need to go out to the world in exotic places to make beautiful pictures or meaningful pictures. You don't. It's really right in your face. I think that reality is more interesting than what we can imagine. Same here, like, again, my grandmother in her home. I just started seeing what was around me, and this will make a beautiful picture. I had no concept of what was gonna emit. I guess light is what really attracts me. You know, light is very important in my photographs, but I don't, how do you describe that to people? How do you tell them this is what I want to do? You know, like my grandmother, she's like, why do you want me to sit here? And I'm like, oh, it's the light, the way it shines on you. She's like, I don't know what you mean. Then she saw it and she's like, oh, it's a nice picture, but it's more than that. You know, I was telling Trevor, like, that now this same place, because this is our home, none of that exists. It's now gray. And I have this picture that one day in the future, I'm going to juxtapose this image with that other image. So I'm learning that the work that I make could be used in other contexts too. So don't throw away anything that you have. I don't like even test strips. If you're in dark room, like all my the papers that I use to test out, you know, my exposure and all that, I keep that stuff and I apply it to other things. But, you know, it's funny that I was telling Trevor that this image, the photograph of my great grandfather is that, you know, it's the one with the ribbon. My great grandfather didn't want ever to be photographed while he was alive. So I kept that image and now it's in my studio in Connecticut. But that's him in his coffin, which you're looking at. And I was telling Trevor the story and I'm like, you know, this picture, man, this is something that is wild because it's a picture of someone that doesn't want to, that never wanted to have his image out in the world. And now it's like a picture of a picture and it's here. You know, it's, and I think about like those things are also very important in why I make images. You know, at the same time, in this body of work, I am recording our history, my history. No one could tell, no one could tell it the way I could. I don't know if I'm making any sense, but it's like I have control of that to tell my story. And that's another thing that I encourage you all to really look into your lives and your moments and record that and express it. Because it's there are times of your life. This image is called El Conejo. It's a bus service that exists here in Chicago that will take you to various parts in Mexico. So you're on a 32 bus ride. My parents will send me to Mexico every summer. I didn't know what a summer was in Chicago until I was 19 years old. And the reason they did that was because they didn't want me hanging out in the neighborhood with the knuckleheads during the summer. My neighborhood was extremely violent. So I would travel to Mexico either by plane or by bus, or sometimes in my dad's van. And this is a stop. This is a stop in Laredo, Texas. And this image was made with a more spontaneous camera, a 35 millimeter. So I made this book with images that both have view camera images, 35 millimeter images, and 2 1/4. Something that when I was being educated to be a photographer was something you didn't do. You couldn't even mix color with black and white. That was a no-no. Probably for you, many of you, you're like, what does that mean? Because now you have total freedom. You could do whatever you want with images. But back when I was in school, you couldn't do a presentation of a project that you were working on with images that, you know, had images in color and black and white, or even mixing cameras. That's like, why would you do that? You know? So making this book, I also realized that I wanted to answer to my professors in a way, like I am a photographer, be it 2 1/4, be it 35, be it 4x5. And I'm mixing color with black and white. And I think it's something that I still am constantly challenging myself with in how I see the world and how I make images. Because I say this, the instructors that inform me in how to be a photographer are really in my, you know, in my blood. Like the way I photograph, it's a very traditional way. Yet I didn't live those times that they were living when they were young and going to school. So at the moment, I am coming to many realizations in how do I become the real Daniel Ramos? Who is Daniel Ramos? And it's a question that I will probably be asking myself for the rest of my life. And how do I constantly challenge myself in with the work that I do? And that's the, you know, to me, that's a big big thing. Like this picture, I was really forced. I really went to this playground and I wanted to make an image of Philo with my son. This is my son's friend. But I wanted them to be on a slide. And I was so like angry at them because they were playing in these leaves. They were playing dead, like let's hide and, you know, and we'll play dead. And that's what they were doing. And I'm like, hey man, stop messing around because I want this picture. And then something, again, I looked, I said, no, the picture that I'm trying to make, that's a picture that I'm trying to make for other people, a formal one. And this is, again, this is one a picture that I will make. And those choices are the things that you need to be aware of when you're out making your work, be it photography, painting, or whatnot. I think that most great things that you do are actually done like really fast. That when the more you try to add to it, it starts losing its vigor. And again, like I this image, none of it happened. None of this actually, these kids don't even play here. But by scouting and going back to the Sloan series, I had this idea of like looking for places and then putting people in them so I could make pictures. And as a black and white photographer or someone that really studied the technicality of making pictures in black and white, I knew in my head that I was going to get these variations of grays and blacks and whites in the image. I knew that. They had no clue that, like, why would you want a picture in this mess? But I knew there was beauty in these tones. But I learned these things through, you know, going to a very technical and formal school. So at the same time, as I say, no, I don't want to be them, I kind of do, and it's like a mixture. Like I take the best out of it. You know, like knowing these rules or knowing these skills allow me then to make pictures that are raw in itself. They're pretty nasty. Like you don't want to be hanging out here. But how do you make something beautiful out of something that is not beautiful when you actually see it? And again, I think that had to do a lot with the choice of working with a large format camera, because I knew that what I was experiencing or what I was seeing day to day was not pretty. And doing it with a 35 millimeter and having that rawness, like a Robert Frank image, or wouldn't help the situation that I was in. So even though the experiences I was having in my life were not pretty, I still love them. I still love my neighborhood. I still love going to Mexico and hanging out. I knew that a camera like a 4x5 would allow me to show that beauty through tones. And here's the image of my father, my mother, and my uncle. Again, this is a trip. This is the van that's still in our lives. They stopped on the road and I said, I would like to make a picture of you guys traveling into Mexico. And it's something that I did over and over. I didn't know that one day all this body of work will be something cohesive. I just love making pictures. And this is one of the last pictures I made of my grandmother in 2018. And again, like she's been a subject. She's the same person in the photograph in color. But again, it's like me photographing the same people over and over. And I just recently was in Mexico this past July, and I went back to the town of Lampazos. So the title of the book is The Land of Illustrious Men. That's the town slogan where my grandmother and mother are from. So I got the title from actually looking up at the sign and reading The Land of Illustrious Men. That's how the title came upon. And I decided to make the title The Land of Illustrious Men because I used to tease my grandmother when I was a young kid. Where are these illustrious men in this dusty Mexican town? Where are they? And she knocked some sense into me. I remember her telling me that she hoped that I would be one of those. And I was just like, how do I argue with that, right? Or how do you live up to that? And when I look at the work, the illustrious people to me are actually my family. They're the ones that actually, in some way or another, pushed me. I don't know how. You know, when I explained earlier that my father wasn't happy when I resigned from Sloan, it took me a long time to understand why. Because clearly I could see him, me now being a father, he didn't know how to guide me in this artwork. So because he didn't have that control, that frustrated him. But yet, I had to push for myself, and I had to navigate through myself and how to figure out this world, which I still am. So me being here and sharing these things to you is actually a pleasure, because I know what it feels like to be on that side. Because I've been at lectures where I was a student and wondered, how do you do this? How does this happen? It's a lot of work, and I never gave up. I had all types of odd jobs, but I kept photographing. And I kept thinking about how to challenge myself, which brings me to the series, Eres Muy Hermosa. You are beautiful. You are very beautiful. And I was living in Mexico making this book, The Land of Illustrious Men. I wasn't making that many pictures that I decided that I wanted to go and make the hardest situation for me to make a picture. And a lot of it had to do with me making a choice of going to the places where I will hang out at night. I love cumbia music. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this music. It's an accordion, very fast-paced music that originated in Colombia. And the city of Monterrey has adapted this genre. There's people that think that they're descendants from Colombia and are living in Monterrey. It's a huge, huge movement. And I love hearing this music, but the places they play it at are not very welcoming, or they're not very pretty, to say. They're dingy, dark, sweaty bars. So I said, I'm gonna make pictures in here. And I worked in one bar, actually two, but imagine you come in with this view camera in these spaces and one strobe light, and you ask people you want their photograph. But I already had, you know, practice, because I had the Sloan series experience. So this time I knew exactly what I had to do, is just put the camera, sit down, and people will come to you. They're going to ask you, what is this about? Who are you? What are you doing? Etc. Of course, I first spoke to the owner of the bar. She thought I was going to make a business where I would charge people for their pictures and I would walk around and just take, you know, 35 millimeter images. So when she actually saw me come with all this equipment, she was like, wow, you are really serious about making photographs. I'm like, yeah, this is how I work, and I will stay out of your way. She's like, yeah, no, you do whatever. So I said to myself, okay, I'm gonna go out there and make pictures of people, right? Mostly people. But then being out at night, traveling to these places at wee hours, I started seeing a Mexico that most people don't actually see, because our ideas of Mexico, because of what's the narrative here about Mexicans in Mexico, is a very negative one. And there are things that are completely out of control, super violent, but not all of it. And I wanted to show that part. I wanted to say, okay, Trump, you're bad hombre, you're bad man. This is what it looks like. Do you feel those vibes of this person? Do you feel that badness that you love to talk about? And at the same time, as I was making this work and they found out that I was actually from the United States, they started sharing their story to me about how one day they wish they could be in the United States, or they wanted to come to the United States, but they were old and they gave up on that dream. So they decided to make their life in Mexico. But yet there was one individual that I can't forget his insight, where he explained to me that in some way he is in the United States. He's like, by you making a picture of me and then showing it in the United States, I'm there. And that blew my mind. Because I was like, you're right. You're showing yourself to the world, to the United States, in the place that you wanted to come one day, but didn't happen. And that really motivated me more to like make more pictures. So I decided to then set up a studio inside this bar. I was very, very inspired by the work of an African photographer from Mali, Sedou Kieta. And he will actually have a studio in the street. And people will, you know, he has pictures with people in mopeds and with the things that they love. But he did that for a business. That was the way he took care of himself and his family. And in my case, I was doing it for more of a art purpose. I had a vision. This came out of my money. This is me investing. And doing so and giving people prints, I also realized that not everyone has the luxury to have a picture made of themselves. There were people that, for the first time, when I gave them the print, they were in shock in how they looked. And they would tell me, is that really me? I'm like, yeah, that's you. But what they meant is, what they were seeing about themselves, the psychological part, was something new to them. And that really made me realize that I was doing my job, because that's what I wanted the work to do. And I explained earlier that what you're seeing is not only a portrait of a person, but it's also a reflection of who I am and how they perceive me. And how I got interested in portraiture, it had to do a lot with an experience I had as a kid. I was about 9 years old, and I had a friend. His name is Jose. And Jose and I would love to garbage pick on Sundays because we had a clubhouse. And we would go garbage picking and get things for our clubhouse. And in one of those occasions, I found a replica of a Rembrandt, right? Self-portrait. I didn't know who that was. You know, when you're a kid, I didn't know who that old man was. Until later, when I was in college, I studying art, I'm like, oh, that's that painting or that piece of paper that I found in the trash. And I decorated it in my clubhouse. But I remember telling Jose that what I saw in that old man was more of me than of him. And Jose was like, well, you're like a kid and that man's an old man. How can you see yourself? But that idea stuck to my head about portraiture. And when I started making pictures of people, I started telling people, actually, the people that see the photograph of you are really going to see something about themselves. So that really relaxed things for people in how they were going to be photographed. So that's a tip that I'm giving you in how you could approach someone by letting them know that actually they're not going to be thinking about you when they're seeing the picture mostly. And that is a big, big shift, because then they relax and they're like, hey, why am I so uptight? Why am I so nervous? It's really showing more about the other person. And here are the images of the scenes that I was looking at on my way to that bar. And I know there's no people, but I wanted you to get a sense of what it's like, you know, at night. There's this, you know, the city of Monterrey is a city of almost 7 million people. And come night, They're all inside these look, you know, they look like warehouses. Loud music is blasting inside these warehouses. And then there's these, this environment happening that I thought was, you know, kind of opposite. And it's mood. Even though, again, decay, a city that's basically run down, it still has some poeticness. And this is the example that I talk about, the portrait. How is it that this woman is giving you a gaze of how strong she is and what she's been, you can feel what she's been through, you know, and how I choose people too. Not everyone, after a while, you're the one rejecting people. I mean, there were people here like, oh, I want a picture with my kids, so-and-so. And I'm like, no, nah, I don't do that. I'm not a studio photographer. And they will try to pay me. I'm like, no. It's also your, like, you pay attention. Some people are interesting and some other people are not. But that's something that you will discover on your own. Like you pick them, you know, like you, like a director will work with a certain actor for movies. It's the same with when you go on location to make a portrait of something. You spot them out, you could feel it. And again, this is an example of how I put myself in the picture. I like to talk about things that I've lived and that I'm interested in by either music or my neighborhood, my people. I think that when you work with something that you know really well, it's actually making things easier for you in the long run. You know, you start, you know, you, I didn't look at this as a job. It was something that I actually loved doing, going out to these clubs at night, hearing the music. And I said, why not combine it with pictures? And then those pictures, how they started informing other ideas. But I went back again to photography. I think I keep on coming back to photography. No matter how much I try to get away from photo, I just, gotta get that, you know, 4x5 or that film and the darkroom. It's something that it's now a part of me, which I encourage you all to find whatever you do and then just own it. Thank you. Yes. How I sell and who buys. At the moment, the work I sell is usually out of my studio. And how I sell it, I make additions. So each image, most images actually, I make an addition of 4. So I have 4 copies, or I make 4 copies, and then I keep 2. And those are called artist proofs. But those artist proofs are like my bank for my child. They're the ones that he's going to keep. So the proofs, that's that. And then depending, so I start with a price. The first image is a certain amount. And I do that, there's a formula, believe it or not. And I have this formula depending on, you know, I use it on the awards and who has collected and where is my work. So then that's how I put a value to it. So when you're beginning, then you got to be realistic in how much your work is actually worth. And the idea is for you not to get rich overnight. Got to be, you know, but then I'm a person that never knew about money, right? Like I think that it's a good thing to sell, to make, you know, a living, but it's not something that influences my work. I gave you that Rembrandt story, but in my mind, then later on, how I experienced art for the first time was not in someone's home. It was in a museum. So when I went into this museum and I saw the work on the walls, I said to myself, I want to make work that belongs in these spaces. And there's work that could be commercially and you could be successful in that. But that's not my interest. I would like for my work to live in public spaces, and there'll be buyers for that. So you build your prices little by little. I hope that answers your question. Yeah, so, yes. What do I think about cell phones making photographs? I think it's great. I think if Ansel Adams was alive, he'll probably be shooting lasers out of a scanner and recording in the world. I think that what's important is for you to find what's the tool that helps you express your idea to the fullest. How I explained earlier, the reason I wanted a 4x5 is because I wanted those sensual tones. I wanted those beautiful gradations of black to white. And I knew that the only camera that will allow me to get something like that was a view camera because of the large negative. That negative is able to carry that information. Now, if I wanted something more spontaneous, like I have this, I'm working on this actual big piece, and they're all cell phone pictures that I made in my life. And I'm printing them in like these Kodak, like what you will get at Walgreens. And I don't know if they still do that, but it's this idea of how I'm able to create moments out of something so cheap. But when you see the bigger thing, it's like, wow. So I think you just need to find the right tool. And I think that putting it out on the world as fast as we do now, like posting, you're basically publishing yourself. You're out in the world. And in my time, that was just unreal. You couldn't do that. So for me, when I did The Land of Illustrious Men, the way that book got out to the world was through Instagram. I made 50 copies. Each book was $250. And I made this book with a publishing house in Mexico City called Hydra. Now, Hydra wanted me to make an offset book, which means have like 500 or 1,000 copies. But you wouldn't have this actual book the way I envisioned it, which was inside a case, and there was two books, certain papers that I printed on. If I wanted to do that with a publishing house, that would have costed me a fortune. And then I had to worry about distribution. I wasn't interested in that. So when I told them, you know what, I'm going to make this with my wife. She's going to bind it. She's going to make the boxes. We're going to use InDesign and make this book. Her answer to me was like, you think you're going to sell 50 books for $250? I'm like, I'm going to try. And I did, all through Instagram. And that book then allowed me to make an exhibition at Art Pace, which is, you know, one of the best experiences I've had in my life. I actually proposed that book becomes a 3D experience in a gallery. I put the van inside, the van that you saw in the picture, it was in there, a vitrine. I brought furniture from Mexico. But that book allowed me, like I said, I never thought that book was going to be an exhibition. I never thought those photographs would be, I just saw it as a beautiful book. So one thing leads to another, you know, like I think that there might not be some money made, but it leads to other opportunities. Yes. Give me a second. I am currently an artist in residency in a mall, an actual mall. There's a Macy's right in front of my studio. And it smells like pretzels. There's carousels. And, you know, when I was growing up, the mall was the space to go hang out and go meet some girls and all that, right? And now that's like a dying culture, right? It's like, it's funny because there's these Amazon lockers inside the mall and people go and pick up their things. And there's an abandoned Sears, what used to be a Sears outlet store. I would like to have access, which I'm trying to get access into this Sears and make something with light and air. I don't know. I don't know if they're going to be photographs or documents of me actually destroying the Sears. But that's what's in my mind. Yeah. Sure. Yes. One thing that I encourage you all that I think I wish I knew is tell more people what you would like to do, what you see, what you want. I was very shy about that. I didn't tell people I was an artist until 2018. There was a write-up in the New York Times. Kid you not, I used to have Facebook, and I see the posts of my friends back in the neighborhood, in the hood, right? They're posting on Facebook, my boy's an artist, and they put the link to the New York Times. I was like, wow, I got the credibility, right? And it shook something in my head again. I said, I am that person. And I started seeing the world as an artist 24/7. And I started telling people, I am an artist. This is what I do. Like, I just share this idea with you about the mall. You never know. Like, oh, you know what? There's this other mall that you might want to see. And things start rolling. I think the more people know what you do or what you want to do, the better. Because believe it or not, someone's going to help you along the line and tell you, oh, you need to go talk to this person or that person. And I used to do that with music. I'm a huge music, like, fan. Like, I buy music like no one's business. I'm very eclectic. And in the music scene, you know, you hear about musicians like talking to people like, oh, I'm hearing this, I'm hearing that. And they get you into other things. So I don't know why I didn't realize that earlier. I mean, I guess that's how you just talk and the word gets out. Yeah. I'm sorry, I can't hear you. So like I had to live like these double personalities, I guess multiple personalities. Like when I was with my family, I never talked about this. I just didn't. We'll talk about other things. And like I said, until recently now, they're like, well, yeah, that's our cousin or, you know, my brother or whatnot. He he does this photography stuff, and he it's still not something that my family understands. I don't think they will. Most recently, I had it's an exhibition that's happening now in Texas, and my father lives in Texas, so he came to it. And for the first time, I don't know if you remember this image of a cowboy by a jukebox. I never heard my father tell me he likes my pictures. Never. Until he saw that picture. You know what he told me? He's like, oh, that's a good picture, man. That was it. And I was like, I want to cherish this moment. And I went and the conversation ended. We didn't talk about photography. We started talking about politics and other things. But, you know, I have a dream where this Mexican part of me, I wish my work one day is in institutions in Mexico. I think that what people in Mexico imagine what the life is of a Mexican in this country is completely skewed. And vice versa. Like, you know, there's an image in the exhibition that Trevor was telling me that he didn't know that it was solarized. And it's an image of a man, which is my father. And it's a river, and it's actually El Rio Grande, Rio Bravo, which is the natural border between Texas and Mexico. And my father is looking back to Mexico. And I was making an image of the ocean because that's the mouth of the river. That's where the Rio meets the Gulf of Mexico. And I'm over here like, yeah, this is the picture. Then I turn around and I see my father looking back, and I'm like, oh no, that's the picture. So I just did this and then clap. Afterwards, I speak to my father. I'm like, because my mother, her dying wish was to be buried in Mexico. I mean, my mother didn't learn how to speak English. She's like, this is not my country and I don't belong here. I'm here until I retire and then I'm going back to Mexico. That was her mission. I thought it was kind of bizarre because I'm like, Mom, you spent 40 years of your life or more than 40 years of your life in the United States and it's not home. I'm like, come on, you know? Anyway, she passed away, and she got her dying wish. She was buried in her town. But then I asked my father, I go, Dad, you know, whenever you pass away, which I hope it's in a very long time, where would you like to be buried? And his answer just shocked me, because he said, I don't want to be buried in Mexico. That country never cared about me. I was like, oh. Man, that's, you're saying a lot of things there, man. Like you're, and I don't think he considers himself Mexican or American. I don't know what, like, what is his, I think he thinks of himself more of a Chicagoan, because even in Texas, he's wearing like Chicago Bulls jerseys and Bears. I'm like, he has more love to Chicago than I do, that I was born in Chicago. So, His point of view, most Mexicans won't agree with, because most of them, you know, they're sending remittance to Mexico for them to have a home out there, build a home and retire. And I've actually seen these towns, you know, recently before COVID in 2020 in January, my father and I traveled to Jalisco, to a town where his coworker is from, and he invited us. And in this town, it's in Puerto Suelos, Jalisco. I think the whole town worked at Sloan Valve. And you could tell the houses. You could tell this money came from the States, and they build these mansions. I mean, they're like huge blocks of cement, but no one lives in them. They're living here because their kids don't want to go to Mexico. So their grandkids are like, nah, Dad, you know, Grandpa, I'll visit you, but I'm not going to live here, type thing. And I'm like, wow, what a thing. So when you ask about Mexican and how do they perceive it, I would like to show what I'm talking about now in Mexico, what how they perceive it, you know? Because I can't imagine, like, I've never been in a situation where my situation is so desperate that I have to leave the country that I'm from. Like, when I think about what my father did and my mother, I'm like, you're crazy. Like, how do you go to a country where you don't know the language, you have no one, and you're like, I'm going to go there for to make a living, because the situation back home is just jacked up, right? But who, I wouldn't do that. Even, I don't know, I don't think I have the skills or the courage to do something like that. Like, it's mind-blowing for me, you know, and this Land of Illustrious Men, it talks about migration, huge, because what does it mean when someone decides to leave all of that behind? Like, that's some serious stuff. Like, you're like, hey, you know what? I'm leaving my friends, I'm leaving everything, and I'm out. Where I'm going, I don't know. My father's destination was Houston, the coyote, the human smuggler. They were taking him to Houston. And surprise, they dropped him off on Kedzie and Cermak in dead of winter. They never seen snow. I'm like, that man's choice, like, this is the tripped out thing. That man deciding my dad's fate is the reason I'm born. Because my mother's from Monterrey, my father's from Guanajuato. They met in Chicago. So this whole thing is like, you know, I think that's why the work with photography and the ephemera, like, it's to me, like, they're moments that like, I really am setting my ground here, you know, like, this is the record. This is what happened. But with also that drama. I grew up with soap operas, man. You know, the telenovelas were like always blasting in my house. I grew up with that, like, there's that drama in it. Yes. What helped me make images in black and white? Oh, what? How I decided to print it the size that it is? Oh, okay. I decided to make photographs in black and white, again, because of the drama. I think that the tones in black and white pictures, they do something automatically. They create nostalgia, I think. And it's something you think that they were made like many, 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 many years ago, but they were made today, right? But by looking at it, you get this feeling that color doesn't do that for me. Color does actually more of a, like, it's more pretty to me. And black and white has that drama and that rawness, the grain. That's what I like.